Welcome Toastmasters, honored and distinguished guests, and viewers at home. For our, I actually don't know how many meetings we've had. This is our August 22nd, 2016 meeting. Welcome all. The meeting theme tonight is heritage. Nice quote to go along with that is from Steve Barry. A concerted effort to preserve our heritage is a vital link to our cultural, educational, aesthetic, inspirational, and economic legacies. All the things that quite literally make us who we are. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce our president, a man who knows exactly who he is, Rick Starr.
That answers the question, how many Toastmasters does it take to hang a bat? Welcome everyone, welcome our fellow Golden Speakers Toastmasters, welcome our viewers at home, and welcome our guests. I'd like to make you all as uncomfortable as possible, so please just stand up and tell us your name and what brought you to Toastmasters.
It's Gabe Hauger. And what brought me here is learning how to communicate, I think is the best thing I can say. I'm not exactly sure.
Thank you.
Hello everyone, I'm Cassie. I'm just came here like 3 days. So thank you.
Hello everybody, my name is Jack and I study in MUM and she is my wife and I'm new here and I want to make a friend with you guys. Thank you.
Thank you, honored guests. We're glad to have you. You're always welcome here. Who has one of these? Please turn it off, put it on silent. Keep the meeting calm and peaceful. Just as a reminder, for all of you who have a role, good to bring your competent leadership manual so you can have your role evaluated and you get credit for it. This is getting a competent leader award is the easiest thing in the world because you come to Toastmasters anyway, you participate, you take roles, and this is a way to get credit for those. I'd like to read our club mission. We provide a safe, supportive, and positive learning experience in which club members are empowered to develop communication and leadership skills, resulting in greater self-confidence and personal growth. And we have fun doing it. We're going to have a great meeting tonight, including one person giving their first speech, their icebreaker. Him and two other wonderful speeches. And now it's my pleasure to introduce our Toastmaster for tonight, who is our Master of Ceremonies, Jean Symington Craig.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just want to ask, Amaya, are you responsible for these two?
I guess so.
You invited them?
Yes.
All right. And Gabe, you mentioned that somebody had told you about it from here. Can you
right.
just say?
Seth Braun.
Yay, Seth! Seth, if you're watching. Okay.
Even from a distance.
Even from a distance. We're going to go through our different role players now and understand their contributions to the meeting. So first I'd like to hear from our timer, Susanna McCann, who will be telling us how she'll be timing tonight.
Good evening, Madam Toastmaster and fellow members and people at home. I'll be timing this evening the three main speakers, actually the first speaker will have from 4 to 6 minutes for the icebreaker. The other speakers, main speakers, will have 5 to 7 minutes. And so, for example, with the main speaker at 5 minutes, I turn on the green light. At 6 minutes, there's a yellow light. At 7 minutes, there's a red light, and you then have 30 seconds to completely finish if you haven't already. And then for table topics, it's 1 to 2 minutes. The speech evaluators have 2 to 3 minutes, and the general evaluator has 3 to 4 minutes.
And Susanna, can you go through on each of those and show us when you're going to go, because these lights will start flashing, and we wanted to make sure we know what those are.
Okay. Here's the green light
at
whatever the smallest amount for your speech is. For example, with the icebreaker, that's supposed to be 4 to 6 minutes. And so at 4 minutes, I would turn this on. At 5 minutes, you would get this.
Yellow. Okay.
And then at 6 minutes, you get the red. And then you have 30 seconds in which to finish.
Okay. Could you show table topics then also?
Okay. With table topics, at 1 minute, you would get the green light. And then at 1 minute and a half, you get the yellow light. At 2 minutes, you would get the red light, and then you have 30 seconds to finish.
Okay. I think we got one more. Let's do the evaluators, too.
Okay. For the evaluators, as you're evaluating, at 2 minutes, the green light would come on. At 2.5 minutes, the yellow light would come on. At 3 minutes, the red light comes on. And then you have 30 seconds to finish.
Okay. Thank you. Susanna, we also have, on top of all the different ones, we also have Jeff, who's going to be doing an advanced speaker project, and he is asking for, and it looks like it's been spelled out here, but just 3 minutes you do a green, 4 minutes you do a yellow, 5 minutes you do a red.
Okay.
And then he wants to, he's supposed to get 3 minutes after that.
For questions.
So, as soon as you see the red, you've got, as soon as he gets the red, you need to start giving him an extra 3 minutes. And how do you just want to?
Yeah, just like green on 2 minutes or something.
Okay.
So your total would be up to 6 minutes total?
Up to eight.
Eight.
Oh, eight.
Okay. So I know these are a little funny.
3, 4, 5 plus 3.
Give him the red. Give him the red at 5, but immediately keep going with this, with the up to 3 minutes.
Okay.
And at 2, give him the green. At 2.5. Give him the yellow, you know, the second part, that 3 minutes where he's doing questions.
Okay, it says here 3 minutes at the beginning, then 4, then 5.
Right, and then look underneath that, plus
and
3.
Then plus 3.
So I'm talking about that plus 3.
Okay.
Oh. When you get to 5, hit the red, and then immediately keep going with the timing, and at 2 more minutes, hit green, 2.5, hit yellow, and at 3, hit the red. I know, and but the main thing is that you're in agreement.
Yeah, thank you. I think.
Would it be the second timing after 5 or after 5.5, since he has an extra 30 seconds?
No, he's supposed to.
I'm confident we're going to be well within time.
Okay.
Okay.
So 5 minutes. So at basically 7 minutes, I would do the red again.
The green.
Green. Okay.
7.5, we'll do the yellow. And just, he'll be watching for you, so when you flash the red at 5, just, you know, Jeff kind of just nod or something like, yeah, I got it.
Okay.
Okay?
Good.
Woo.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, now, just guess. Clapping is really essential for Toastmaster meetings, and so if you feel a little funny about it, I want you to just get over it. So now we're going to clap Susanna, because that was quite a... better too. It just feels good to clap. It really does. All right. Thank you, Susanna. Our next role player is our grammarian, and that will be Rick Stark.
Thank you. The role of the grammarian: listen to the language used by members during the meeting. Make a note of any exceptionally good or bad uses of language. Give a brief report at the end of the meeting about what you observed. Listen for use of the word of the day and report at the end of the meeting who used it most. The word of the day is heritage. Heritage is a noun. It means something that is handed down from the past as a tradition. An example of heritage in a sentence is, while cherishing all things American, Subha was still very proud of her Indian heritage.
We had a couple more people arrive. We're going to keep rolling, but it is the heritage of Golden Speakers Toastmasters to have a variety of people, a variety of lives, so we're all in this together. Okay, good. Our next role player is our odd counter, and that would be Amaya Zhu.
Is to note words and sounds used as a crutch or filler word by anyone who speaks during the meeting. I will watch and report us and us during the meeting, as well as other filler words, such as and, well, but, so, you know. I will also note repeated words or phrases. Thank you.
Okay. We seem to be missing a general evaluator for tonight. Who should we Andal.
Yes, I could do it, and I'm the table topic.
Oh, you're also the table topics. Okay, season Toastmasters. Rick, are you, do you want to do that? Yeah, okay, so you're the grammarian. Okay. So Rip will be our general evaluator, and we will hear from him later on. And our greeter and our joke master was the lovely Andal Krishna, and we will be hearing from her as well later. All right, I think we're ready. Any final questions before we shut the door and we take off on the runway? Okay, very good. We're ready to go into the prepared speeches now. Our first speaker is going to be Jeff Shipley, and his evaluator is Dan Craig, who will be reading the objectives for this speech and also the introduction.
Thank you, Madam Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, viewers at home, honored guests. Tonight, Jeff is going to be doing a project from an advanced manual. He's finished his competent communicator manual, so he's now working in advanced manuals. And he's in a manual called Public Relations. This is Project 2. It's the radio talk show. So first thing I'm going to do is read the objectives for the project from the manual. He's to present a positive image of you and your company or organization on a simulated radio talk show. Prepare a talk designed to build goodwill toward an organization by presenting factual information. Understand the dynamics of a successful radio talk show. And finally, prepare for the questions that may be asked of you during the radio interview. What is your title, Jeff? I don't have
Blue Jay.
Blue Jay hashtag?
Sure.
Or hashtag Blue Jay?
No, there's actually the vertical second one.
I don't actually have an introduction, but Jeff tells me that he's making a great effort these days to be more authentic. And he's also a newly finished ragby rider. He rode all the way across Iowa this last week with the hordes going all the way. Sunburned nose, and he's going to give us this project. Welcome, Jeff Shipley. He He's going to be working with Will Burns on the project, and I believe Will is going to actually introduce Jeff.
Okay,
very good.
And we're back. Welcome to episode 28 of Golden Speakers Radio. Tonight we have a special guest with us, a man nearly all of Jefferson County has heard of, and arguably Fairfield's most eligible bachelor. Lately, Jeff has been channeling his inner charisma and personality in a new direction, stand-up comedy. Now the question, Jeff, on everybody's mind is, what is hashtag Blue Jay?
Thanks, Will, for the introduction. It's a pleasure to be with you today on Golden Speakers Radio. Really, it starts moving to Fairfield 5 years ago, and how Fairfield, I love to call it, it's a real safe place for people who want to express themselves. It's the country's largest retirement community, or no, excuse me, most spiritually smug retirement community. And so living in Fairfield, you kind of have a safe place to really find out who you really are, if that's not too cliche to say. And one of the themes of my exploration has been authenticity. And the stand-up comedy, I believe, what came to me is that really it just takes getting up on stage and being honest in front of people to kind of create a laughter or create a resonance with the crowd. And so that's what I've been really experimenting with. And one of the tools that helped me learn about this would be the spirit totem, the blue jay, which is a very regal animal. And if you look at the blue jay in nature, it's really peculiar because there'll be a bunch of birds and they'll be very peaceful, and then the blue jay will come and start pushing the other birds around and pecking at them and just being really irritating and looking real good while doing it. So to me, the blue jay is all about experimenting with pushing those boundaries and establishing my own boundaries and establishing that pecking order. And specifically with the literature that I looked up is about the proper use of power and the connection. Well, this was a Native American. It talks about the connection between heaven and earth, whatever. But specifically to me, it meant so in this comedy, you know, you could use laughter to enlighten and uplift and heal the world through laughter. Or you could use humor to viciously humiliate someone. And, going through the creative process, a lot of memories from earlier on kind of get dredged up, and you start thinking of these memories from public school where, that lesson was very evident in the public schools, how you could use humor to viciously humiliate someone. All you really need is an audience. And, it's kind of a sad story. But the opposite is true, that the proper use of humor could be to heal and uplift the world, get people laughing at themselves, really. That's the most emotionally mature
way to use humor.
Well, let me ask you, Jeff. You mentioned that you thought Fairfield was a safe place, but also has a certain amount of smugness.
Uh-huh.
And you're here as our sort of crusading blue jay here to come in. My question to you, sir, is do you feel like there's a healing aspect to humiliation?
No, I don't believe there is. That's why it's within my power to do that, and I'm choosing not to.
Okay.
Right, that's why. Sorry, I forgot to make that point. But I've seen it done, and that's a much more darker, more ruthless line of thought, but I do entertain those thoughts, especially with the Machiavellian aspect. I don't know, I'm a bit of a political scientist, and I've learned a lot from, say, some of those more famous political science texts.
Interesting.
Yeah, it is interesting. Thanks.
When will you be giving your next, when will the Blue Jay come out again?
Well, I thought you had met, did you mention there's a show tomorrow at Cafe Paradiso at 9:15 p.m. I'm the featured performer. I thought that's why I was here.
Indeed. Well,
yeah.
So it's tomorrow. Yep. Indeed, Jeff. We'll be talking tomorrow at Cafe P, the open mic, tomorrow Wednesday, 9:15, at Cafe Paradiso, just north of the square. And looks like we want some questions here from the audience.
Oh, we do? Oh, okay. Sorry, you're the host. I'm See, I'm overstepping boundaries now. This is where a violation, this is where I lose a blue jay feather.
But you're okay, as long as you don't humiliate me. Good point. Then we have a problem.
Speaking of, I am the MC of your wedding, which I just RSVP'd to, so.
So we probably have something to do.
I'll take questions. Anyone have questions?
How did riding across Iowa help you explore your heritage as a European American?
Fantastic question. So riding a bicycle across Iowa is a very white person thing to do, very privileged. We could drive there, but we're going to ride our bikes anyway. I saw two black people. Might have been the same person twice, though. I wasn't quite sure. So you get up close and personal with rural Iowa, which is predominantly white, and these people do open up their hearts and their homes to you. So one of my very meaningful stop I had on day two was a Catholic church and basilica, and they make all the signs on the side of the road and it says, hey, take a pee and pray. So we waited in line at the bathroom for the church for 45 minutes and we prayed and met people, and mostly white. So it was a great coming together of white heritage and recognizing what we are capable of. I mean, it's rural Iowa. Yeah, we're getting up close and personal with rural Iowa, so it's fantastic. I've never felt more affirmed as a white person than when I was trying. But it's cool because the Iowans, they could price gouge, but they don't. It's kind of a competition to see who can give away the most free water, who could give away the most free beer. It is. I'm an evangelist now. I recommend people of all color faiths to participate in the ride across Iowa on the bicycle. It's actually not that difficult. We need support staff as well because it's a logistical nightmare. We think we're helping the environment, but I think if you analyze the logistics of such an operation, it's probably carbon neutral would be my guess. But
did you happen to see any blue jays out there on the
ride? I did collect one blue jay feather when I was searching in the grass for the rosary that I misplaced.
Nice. Yeah. Mr. Shipley, we also had a question here from one of our call-in listeners while you're answering the last question. You mentioned you have a bit of a political interest. And the question was, Mr. Shipley, what makes you think that your latest venture will turn out better than your failed political ones?
It's a fantastic question, Will. Thank you for asking. I guess the main difference between comedy and politics is, one, I've been learning to be more authentic and embrace who I really am. And two, in comedy, there's a setup and a punchline. Mm-hmm. You at least have an additional sentence to explain yourself. I don't think you have that benefit in politics.
Okay.
But in comedy, I learned that Jay Leno got his start being arrested for vagrancy twice on Los Angeles Boulevard in California. I feel I could probably do that.
You feel like he was in some ways a vagrant by just kind of hanging around the office here?
No, I think he was like struggling and poor and started out and then persevered to get to the highest levels of success. Okay. And in the 1980s, he was making jokes about food additives and these horrible ingredients that we put into food. That was 30 years ago.
Okay, speaking about success, tell us about the bandana. Are you the Willie Nelson of comedy?
No, I wish. This is actually to make me feel more like Tupac Shakur, who's also a hero. But I do have Willie Nelson and Tupac somewhat adjacent, their portraits in my home.
Okay, and in your heart.
Oh, yeah, and I'm my record player. That's right.
Well, that's all the time we have today. It's been a fascinating conversation. Once again, if you want to hear Jeff speak, chance to catch Jeff Shipley live at Cafe P Open Mic. That's tomorrow, Wednesday, at 9:15. Thank you very much, Jeff, for taking the time. Thank you all for listening. Thank you for what you do right here on the Old Speakers Radio.
Our next speaker is, oh, sorry, 2 minutes. And Susanna, will you time us for 2 minutes?
Yes.
I know, it's a never-ending moment. So we'll have 2 minutes, and everyone out there in the audience, you have a page, it's about this big. Great. Our next speaker is Sudeep Pradhan. And Sudeep is going to be doing his icebreaker, which is always very exciting for our guests. An icebreaker is your first speech up. And it's where you're getting your legs, getting your legs on the deck, you can get your feel, and we always promise that if you faint or pass out, we will take you back to your seat. We'll get you back there. So no worries. To introduce and read the objectives for Sudeep's icebreaker is his evaluator, Will Burns.
Thank you, Jean. This is a fascinating time, a chance for him to spread his wings. I think Sudeep has some idea of his own abilities, his own talents, but this is a chance for us to kind of see those talents, to experience them firsthand here with the icebreaker. His objective is to begin speaking before an audience and to discover speaking skills that he already has, but that we have yet to experience in their fullest. Sudeep is from Nepal. He was in China for 10 years, studying and working. He is a software engineer and worked for Microsoft in Redmond, Washington, before coming to Iowa. He loves reading books and doing social work. These days, he's helping out with the Habitat for Humanity Restore. He knows 5 languages, which is exactly 4 more I know, Nepali, English, Chinese, Indian, and Nawara, which is a he adores Fairfield and wishes he could live here someday with his family. The title of his speech is Icebreaker, Who Am I? Please join me in warmly welcoming Sudeep.
Madam Toastmaster, fellow speakers, viewers at home, and respected guests. My name is Sudeep. You can call me, this guy is so deep. You can call me, like, so deep, and then you say, like, Sudeep. I've come from 7,600 miles away and descended around, like, 3,000 feet. Dear friends, I'm from Kathmandu, the capital of Nepal, which is located at 4,600 feet high, and is surrounded by the hills and beautiful snow mountains. So till I was 14, I had no idea what's the meaning of horizon. Horizon used to be always the top of the mountain for me. Then when I grew up, I went to a local school and then an Indian school in Nepal. I spent a lot of my time like riding motorbike around the hills and then drinking tea on the rooftop. You might have guessed, looking at the beautiful mountains. But it has been a long time. I left Nepal, 15 years. After my high school, my parents sent me to China for the bachelor. They thought that in China, the education is very strict, no drinking, no beer, nothing. And the agent told them, and actually, that's not the main reason, but I want to say like that that's the reason they sent me there. But it was exactly opposite in China. It's like the free place. It's like the cheap beer, beautiful girls, no study. I was 18 at that time. It was like the fun place for me. Then I did my I did my language in the south, and then I moved to the far north, did my bachelor, and then I came in the middle, like the center, it's Beijing, where I met a girl. We fell in love. I never thought that I'm gonna marry a foreign girl. Love has no boundaries. She's my wife now, and we have a 3-year-old kid. He really likes Spider-Man, and he likes Bruno Mars. He likes the lazy song. He's his favorite, and he knows all the moves. Let's get back to my introduction. I like to call myself as Jack. Jack of all trade and master of none. I'm good at picking up stuff, but not good at master at skills. I remember when I was a kid, I used to write a song and compose music, and my brother used to be the only person who listened to me. Actually, I used to bribe him, beg him, or threat him. And I also have a lot of sports I play, but I'm master of none. right now I've discovered meditation. I'm hoping that meditation will break through that limit and I'll be skillful master at a lot of things. So going back to my professional life, I'm a software engineer. I build things, I build products, I test products. What my specialty is, I build the product to test another product. That's called automation. So we don't have to do it manually, test the stuff. But we build all the whole the system, the system will test system. I really like to listen to the speeches like Obama and things like that. I really love here. And then I hope that I'm gonna be a good speaker by coming here and keep up with the heritage of our environment. That's all. Thank you.
That shaking business, so now we're ready to go for another hand thing that we do. So we've got clapping down. Handshaking is what we do when we're up here before we abandon this, because we never, it's like a baby. You don't want to leave the baby by itself. So we always have to shake hands. That was awesome.
Thank you.
That was awesome. All right, so now we have 2 minutes. Would you time us on the timer, Susanna? And you can fill out an evaluation for Sudeep. You'll notice when you're writing evaluations, it's not, 2 minutes isn't very long, so you just kind of get your main bullet points going there. Oof, that was great. All right, our final speaker for the night is Mahesh Gautam, and his evaluator is Art Atkinson, who will be reading the objectives, and I'm just going to keep pointing out we're working on our audio feed for the videos that we're doing always, and so speaking up is always going to be helpful. All right, good. Everyone's doing that, but I'm just going to say that's something we want to continue. Thank you, Art. All right.
Good evening, guests, Toastmasters, viewers at home. Our next speaker, Mahesh Gautam, has been a member of this club since March of this year, and he arrived in Fairfield in January, I believe. He's an accountant by profession. He's currently working on his second master's degree. His first master's degree in accounting he took in Scotland. He's here working on a related master's degree and a professional certification in information systems accounting auditing. He's a traveler. He's been to several countries in the Eurozone. He speaks three languages, Nepali, Hindi, and English. He's chosen an interesting topic tonight for his project number 4 in the Competent Communicator Manual, which is called, the project is How to Say It. The objectives are to choose very specific, colorful, clear, definite words in arrangement of words to effectively communicate his idea. He's also to use similes, metaphors, figures of speech to juice up the color and intensity of what he's doing, rhetorical devices, and avoid jargon and unnecessary words. The speech is to have a clear purpose and be appropriately organized. His topic title is My Biggest Enemy, his discovery that we have a knack for becoming our own worst enemies. Please help me welcome Mahesh Gautam.
Madam Toastmasters, members, guests, and viewers at home, in case if you do not know the name of my topic, it is the biggest enemy. It is composed from three words, the biggest enemy. What I would like to communicate today, and what I want all of you to take out today, is the greatest enemy is we. We are the greatest enemy. And how I realized in knowing we are the greatest enemy. I'll try to communicate to all of you today. For example, if you have a big plan, if you have a plan, if you want to do something amazing, the other person comes to you and says to you, you cannot do it. Those four words are the most demotivating words in your life. Because you have a big hope and someone else gonna come to you and says, you cannot do it. Similarly, this kind of things happen. The fault is not those people who come to us and say, you cannot do it. The fault is ours. Because we are letting those people stand in front of us and say, and destroy our hopes, and destroy our motivation, and destroy our things to do something special, and just destroy what we want to add to something new. So what I say is destroying someone else is a crime. So they are personally doing a crime to you if anyone says, anyone demotivates you. But the biggest thing is, the bigger crime is not their crime, the bigger crime is our crime. Because what we are doing is we are allowing them. We are allowing them to be in our network. We are allowing them to be in our society. We are allowing them to be in front of us to communicate all those demotivating things. I want to expand this idea further by taking you all into one of the very busy offices. So, everyone, fasten your seatbelt. We are taking for a flight off to a Texas for a big public corporation, which is listed on a, let's say, New York Stock Exchange. And it has got a big money, it has a big heritage of money from the last year's annual accounts. So I'm opening the door of the office. I see a big cabin. I go inside the cabin, then I see a closed envelope like this. One guy comes and he opens the envelope. He sees a letter. It is written, that employee because of whom your growth or promotion was stopped last year, the person has died. If you want to see the person, reach to this address within a single hour. The person becomes happy inside because that was the reason why his growth was stopped in the organization. But inside, he was a little bit sad because the person died. So he quickly goes into the garage, takes his car, and goes to the place. There is a big coffin over there. He just looked at the coffin like this. He had a feeling of fear and a feeling of happiness. But finally he decides to see the face of the person who died. He goes near the coffin. He opens the coffin. He was ashamed of himself. He was so shy of himself. Because there was not a face of the person who was stopping his growth or promotion. There was a mirror. Over there, he could only see his face. So what I would like to say to everyone is there is no one who is stopping our growth. No one in the professional life. No one is in the personal life. We are the one who are stopping our growth. But just a minute. Is that light right?
We're only at about 4 minutes.
Okay.
Oh, I'm
sorry. Okay, no worries. Let me explain to you. Then I have a question. We know that we are the biggest enemy of ourselves. But why we are doing so? Why we are harming ourselves? For example, if I bring some woods over here, if I light a fire, and if I say to one of you, anyone, come forward and put your feet on the fire. Would you come here? Anyone, would you come here? If you want to come here, just raise your hand. No one would come here because we don't want to do our harm by ourselves. But why we are doing so? I had a big question. I was searching for that answer for a long, long time. And then finally I found the answer. I was in a park. Suddenly the rain started. I went to the shade like this. And then all the other people came to the shade as well. On my right-hand side, I could see a couple. They were saying, it's a big rain today. There's gonna be a huge traffic. It's gonna take a long time to reach home. On the front of mine, there was a husband and a wife. The husband was saying, I already told you, bring an umbrella. Look, it's raining now. I can't go to the office. On my backhand side, there was a guy. He was so weight. He had a note of like $10. He wanted to make it dry, blowing it dry. And then I saw a man. He was with his child. She was a little girl of about age 5. The guy was coming like this to the seat. On the other hand, he was holding his daughter. Then suddenly, the daughter asked, "Dad, why doesn't it rain like this?" Because she was enjoying the rain. She was putting her hands like this and putting all the water to her face, sometimes drinking the water. The dad was, that was busy on the mobile. He said, "Yeah, it does rain every day." The child was not satisfied with the answer. She said, "Dad, why doesn't it rain every day?" This time the guy had no answer. The guy had no answer. The child couldn't get the answer, but I could get the answer. I could get the answer of my question, why we want to do our harm to ourselves. What I saw was some people were coming like this. But the little girl was coming like this. She was taking absolutely everything what was given to her. She was enjoying everything. And the main thing was she was asking the questions. That what we used to do when we were a child. That's what the big people have done always. For example, let us take an example of a Newton. Apple fell into his tree. He said, "Why the apple fell into his tree? Why this apple fell into his tree?" Take an example of Wright brother. He made an airplane. He said, "Why can't I fly?" All those achievements have come from questions. So what I want you, all of you, to take out for today is just don't stop. Keep asking the questions. Don't put your hands like this. Put your hands like this so we can bring a lot of achievements in our life. Thank you.
Susanna, will you time us for 2 minutes now? And let's go ahead and write up an evaluation for Mahesh.
Okay. It's time to vote on our favorite speaker for the night, best speaker. Madam Timer, could you tell us who qualified? You don't have to give us the time, just the names.
Okay. Jeff, Sudeep, and Mahesh, all qualified.
All qualified. Okay, so that's Jeff, Sudeep, and Mahesh. And for guests, we have these little slips of paper, and one little area of it says best speaker, and you can just write the name on that, and then hold your arm up. Going to hand off to our general evaluator. And just one more choreography I'm going to make. So we have clapping, we have shaking. This center area where we have our camera and microphone and stuff is no man's zone. So if you're going to come up and you're part of table topics or whatever, you need to go that way. Okay. Some people have tried to come up that way. You know, we haven't heard from them since. Right? They're gone. They were so promising, too. So that's what happens. All right. We're ready to move on to our evaluation section now, and I'd like to welcome up our general evaluator for the evening, Rick Starr.
Thank you, Jean. Toastmasters, we learn communication skills through two ways. One, by giving speeches ourselves, and the other way, by evaluating people, evaluating their speeches. Toastmasters has no professional teachers, no professional evaluators. You're evaluated by your peer. I'd like to introduce our first evaluator, Dan Craig, who will evaluate Jeff's speech.
Thank you, Mr. General Evaluator, for reminding me I'm a rank amateur. Here to give you my opinion as an evaluator.
The project that Jeff did was called Hashtag Blue Jay, and I'm going to go through the evaluation guide and follow the points that are here. The first thing that's asked in the evaluation guide is, was the guest's expertise clearly established in the host introduction? I had to say no. It was a pretty brief introduction. Basically just said, here's Jeff, and he's expressing himself through comedy. Though I think it is somewhat implied that Jeff is an expert on himself. How relevant was the speech to the audience and its interests and goals? One little side point is we didn't exactly get a 3-minute speech. We had question and answer throughout. But it was interesting to all of us, the subject of his talk and the fact that he's going to be giving a show tomorrow night. How thorough was the speaker's research? I couldn't tell if there was a lot of research, though there was the information about the lore of the blue jay and how that represents pushing boundaries, how it gives lessons about the proper use of power. And I thought the most interesting part of that information was talking about comedy as a way of exercising power. Whereas, you know, on one hand you could tear someone down, on the other hand you could inspire them. How well does the speaker use vocal variety? I don't think I heard a lot of vocal variety. The speaking voice that Jeff has is nice and clear, but it was at the same volume level, the same tempo. I didn't hear the variety. An example of what you could do in answering a question, maybe somebody would say, why are you wearing the bandana? And you could say, well, let me tell you how much I love Willie Nelson. Just a little ramp up in the voice. How effectively did the speaker answer the questions asked? I thought very effectively, very smooth. Jeff is a bright guy. He's got a good delivery. He had good answers to questions about rag bribe, politics, comedy, and the bandana. Assuming you had no previous knowledge of the speaker's organization, were you favorably impressed with the organization after listening to the presentation? Well, it's NA on the organization. That didn't quite work into the project, but I definitely am interested in going to see Jeff tomorrow night do open mic. I'm sure he'll be really fantastic. How effective do you think the speaker would have been on a real talk show? I think quite effective. He's very relaxed, gave good, smooth answers, and so we'll be seeing him on a small screen sometime soon. Mr. General Evaluator.
Now, our second evaluator, Will. Give us evaluation for Sudeep.
Thank you, Rick. And thank you, Sudeep, for sharing some of your story with us tonight. I'm going to go here from the manual. What strong points does the speaker already have? Well, Sudeep can count himself very lucky. He has a number of strong points. Has a strong voice and a story-driven approach to his speeches that allowed us to go so deep into your life. How well did the audience get to know the speaker? I feel like we got to know you quite well. We heard about your childhood, about going off to school, your college in China, falling in love, your professional life, and that you are both a husband and a father. You did a great job of giving these little bits and these beautiful stories about being in the mountains, drinking tea, and riding your bike. Also talking about just leaving us wanting more and engaging us more with each little aspect there. I'm sure there's a lot more to be told about each one of those things. Did the speech reflect adequate preparation? I think it did indeed quite well. I followed it quite well. I thought it was very, very easy to understand. Did you talk clearly and audibly? Yes. I feel like Sudeep spoke very clearly. I was way in the back there, and I had no problem understanding what he was saying and hearing him clearly. Did the speech have a definite opening, body, and conclusion? Now here, I feel like it didn't have as much of a formal structure where I was clear, like, okay, this is the intro, now he's into his body. But I felt like it really, your talk weaved in these memories and the stories of your life into this journey of a hero, about how you're aware of your own weaknesses, but yet you're on this quest for mastery. I thought that was a great job of telling us about your memories, your stories, but also where you're going and what you're looking to do. I thought it was a very powerful thing in your talk here. Comment on the speaker's use of notes. No notes. That's easy. What could the speaker have done differently that would have improved the speech? You did so many things so well that my one suggestion for you would be visual aids. Perhaps bring in a Spider-Man lunchbox, or perhaps even better, bring in a .NET reference manual so we can understand just how being a generalist is easy when you have such a huge body of knowledge to consume. Just a suggestion. But again, I was able to visualize just fine. That's just taking the good to the great. In conclusion, you clearly showed your proficiency in public speaking, and I am so excited to be here. Looking forward to hearing your next speech on the talk about progress in public speaking mastery. Thank you, Steve.
Now I'd like to introduce Art, who will give an evaluation of Mahesh's speech.
Good evening, again, Toastmasters, many guests, new members, viewers at home. I really like this talk. I like the earnestness with which he just dived right into his topic. How is it that although we wouldn't willingly harm ourselves, we do so anyway, and we do so in the most crucial way? I'm going to go through the points of the manual. Was the speech topic appropriate for this particular assignment? I said it was satisfactory. It wasn't particularly appropriate or inappropriate. It was an acceptable topic. Did the speaker use simple, short, and clear words? I said he was excellent with that. Did he use vivid, descriptive words that created mental images? Well, he took great care to create image after image after image. There was the funeral service and the coffin and the mirror and the coffin. There was the little girl, and the umbrella, and the water, and holding your hands this way. He was giving us many gestures. He was creating all these different illustrative situations. Did he use words that had more than one meaning or were inaccurate? I said no. He was fine in that respect. Were the sentences short, simple, and understandable? I thought it was satisfactory. It wasn't particularly one way or the other. Did he use rhetorical devices? Well, all of these illustrative situations were his rhetorical devices. Did he avoid jargon? Absolutely. No unnecessary jargon. Grammar was acceptable. Pronunciation, in one place you used the word umbrella, and the way you said it the first time, it was only by the third time you said it that I got always talking about the word umbrella. Was the speech purpose clear? Well, we got there. The purpose was clear from the beginning that we're going to look at how is it that we do this serious damage to ourselves and become our own worst enemies. It took him a while to get there and to enunciate his own discovery in this area, which is that we stop asking the questions why or why not. What did I think that he could have done to make the speech more effective? I actually felt that if you had used fewer different varied situations you know, we had the fire, we had the umbrella and the rain, we had funeral service, we had so many different situations you were using to illustrate your points. I felt that it would have been more powerful to choose fewer of those. Other than that, and one other thing is you were tending to swallow the last word of the sentence and not speak with full volume to the end of the sentence. So with that, Mr. General Evaluator.
And now, table topics. I'd like to introduce Andal, who is our table topics master.
Thank you, Mr. General Evaluator. Good evening, fellow Toastmasters, guests, and viewers. When we are growing up, we were told stories by our parents, uncles, aunts, and sometimes nannies. That's how we learned about our rich family history and ethnic heritage, whether around the dinner table or the kitchen table or at the back of our porch. These stories helped us envision what was possible and cautionary tales told us what not to do. Let's get ready for our 2 minutes storytelling. I have some story topics and would like some volunteers to start this story. I have some topics and when you come up here I will read the questions and you can tell your story. We can hear, see any volunteer here. Great. Your favorite meal or food, take us to the dining with you. Your story lets us reveal the meal or the special occasion that you had.
Oh man, I've done my favorite or my greatest enemy in so many comedy routines that it's hard for me to avoid it now. So my greatest enemy, my favorite food would definitely be chicken. I mean, I've had so much chicken as a child, it's insane. And every time I go to eat a piece of chicken, it's like, I know what chicken tastes like. But I can't stop myself. It's like I've done vegetarianism, I've done veganism, and it doesn't matter how good this food tastes, chicken still tastes so good. So I guess as a child I did have a love for chicken. Now it is this hatred. The way I think about chicken is, did you know that there's more than one chicken for every human being on this earth? So that they don't take us over, we have to eat them. They're everywhere. Do you want your kids eating chicken? I know I don't. Thank you.
I know what you mean. Even when I was growing up, my favorite was chicken.
Yeah. It's
so good. Let's hear the second volunteer.
Yes, sir, Ellen.
Right.
Sorry.
Your question is, why is bike safety important? You can answer this topic with the story of you as a biker.
I'm sorry, what was the question?
Say it again.
Why is bike safety important?
Okay, dear Toastmasters, guests and viewers at home, I mean, this is a topic that I would love to talk to because I grew up riding a bike because I came from Eritrea, and Eritrea is a place where people tend to use bikes more than they do Yankees. Right, Yankees. Okay. So one day I was riding a bike. Eritrea is like a country where there is a lot of landscapes, so there is a lot of steep roads. Okay, so I was riding a bike, and it's a brilliant bike that I was given by my father, and I was holding a huge books from that I bought to take home, and in Eritrea we don't use helmets or anything of that kind. So I was holding these books and I was going down the road. So at some point the bike started to shake because I was running fast, and then I put the book inside the first wheel of the bike. So what happened was I flipped and I ended up falling on this side of my jaws. And I don't forget that moment because I've lost control. I've been taken to hospital. Then nothing happened, and I came to the U.S. And when I came to the U.S., I saw everybody was wearing helmets. And in Eritrea, if a person is wearing a helmet, it's like everybody looks at him. What is he doing? In the U.S., wearing a helmet is the most important thing because when I was in San Francisco, I was riding a bike, a person found me in the street, and when he saw me without a helmet, he told me he needs me to buy a helmet. And I told him, I'm from Eritrea, I don't need a helmet. So he took me to a store and he bought me a helmet. So what I realized was, at some point, life in Africa and life in the US, the meaning of life is also different, I think. Because I think it's more important in the U.S. than in the U.S. So it's very important to use the
thank you. I can relate that to my story.
Thank you, Undall. I can't get enough of being up here. Plus, this is the only way I figure I can actually beat Dan. Best evaluator is by doubling up the number of entries I get here for two different positions. I don't think it'll work, but it's my latest ploy. So we had two stories here. Undall, thank you, by the way, for being here with Topics Master and sharing your stories here. We had Santoria with your favorite meal, or a meal that you love very much from your childhood, chicken. It also happens to be beloved, but also your greatest enemy. I liked, you had a number of great lines in there, giving me the very important fact that there is a chicken out there for every one of us, or that they're breeding, and if they, you know, run carefully, might overtake us. So, very important public service announcement to make. My suggestion was just, you know, I know you're a very, you know, experienced speaker. Was your tend to kind of clasp your hands a little bit, you know, maybe you were nervous, but I don't know why, you know, you were very, you know, polished and very comfortable otherwise. So that's been one session for you. But again, very, very humorous and very touching story. Thank you. Now, from you talk about bike safety, give us a great story about the book causing you to go flying up over your bike. Now, for me, my suggestion is similar. This is a story of gestures. Commit to it. You kind of had your hands here, then you kind of out, and then you started to commit to your story. You got the books. You're on the bike. I don't know if you have the handles like this, handles like this, but commit to this. You know, get down and just really bring us in there. Make you commit. That's not just for you. But I feel like you, in the end, I don't know if you value your life more here back in Eritrea, but I felt like it was a great close, and thank you to both our table topic speakers tonight.
Thank you, Will. Madam Timer, could you tell us which evaluators qualified, including the table topics evaluator?
Okay. They all did.
Okay.
So Will qualified, Dan Craig qualified, Will qualified for his evaluation of Sunday, and Art qualified.
Thank you.
Actually, Art was, he was okay.
Oh, yay. What? So please vote for your best evaluator, including table topics evaluator, and the candidates are Will, Dan, Art, and Will. And now for the report section of the meeting. And Madam Timer, could you give us the timer's report, please?
Yes, thank you. Do I give each person's time?
Yes.
All right. So Jeff and his talk was 8 minutes and 10 seconds total, which is within his limit. Sudeep was 4.02 minutes, which is very good. Mahesh, 7.03 minutes, very good. And on table topics, Santoria with the chicken, I think was actually a little more than 58 seconds, but I didn't, may not have started on time. And Ephraim on bike safety was about 2.5 minutes, that's fine. Almost went over, but we went down on this. Will, on his table topic evaluation, was 2 minutes and 7 seconds. Dan evaluating Jeff took 3 minutes and 17 seconds. Will evaluating Sandeep took 3 minutes and 1 second. And Art evaluating Mahesh took 3 minutes and 10 seconds.
Now I'll call on Rick Starr to give the grammarian report. Thank you, Rick. So Jeff, couple of interesting use of the language. You can be provocative in Toastmasters. Called Fairfield America's most spiritually smug retirement community. And the religious saying we've all come to love, take a pee and pray. Sudeep, never thought I'd marry a foreign girl, but love has no bounds. That was beautiful. Mahesh, it wasn't something you said, it was just the gestures you used. How a girl was open to the rain, where others were shielding themselves from it, and the girl appreciated the rain so much more. I like that. Couple of areas for improvement. You said it's a big rain today. Probably you could say it's a heavy rain or rained a lot. Taking everything what was given, you could say taking everything that was given. Mandal, cautionary tales told us what not to do. Santori, I have to just tell your joke again. More than there's more than one chicken for every human, so they don't take over. We have to eat them. Yeah. Ephraim, meaning of life is more important in the U.S. than in Africa. And for improvement, you said holding huge books, probably something would be better, holding a large stack of books. For the word of the day, we have a four-way tie, heritage, Jean 1, Santoria 1, Sudeep 1, and Andal 1.
And Mahesh.
And Mahesh 1 also. Thank you. And now the odd counter. Maya, please give us your odd counter report.
Sure. Here's my odd report. Jeff has one arm, three arms, one soap, two end. Will has one end. Mahesh has one soap. Santoria has one soap. That's all, thank you.
Thank you. want to tell us a joke? Randall.
Two elderly ladies who were best friends for decades, and then they used to meet every now and then and share their adventures and activities. Lately, their meeting got reduced, and they would meet once in a week to play cards. One fine day, it happened that they were meeting to play the cards. Both of them were playing cards. Suddenly, one lady looked at the other one and said, "You shouldn't get mad at me. I'm going to ask you something." And the lady looked and she said, "I've been thinking really hard and I just couldn't remember. I know we have been friends for quite a long time, but I just can't remember your name." And this lady, she looked at her and she said, she just looked at her and glared and stared at her, and like, and then she kept staring at her for 3 minutes, and then she asked the lady, "How soon do you want me to say?" Because she forgot to.
And now I will evaluate the evaluators. Dan gave Jeff his evaluation. Dan greeted the audience. He went through all the preliminaries during the introduction, project objectives, etc. When he came up to give the evaluation, he didn't greet the audience then. He went through the manual, all the objectives, which was good. He had good eye contact with the whole audience, which is very difficult when you're reading your notes for an evaluation. You either look down at your notes, or sometimes you just speak directly to the person being evaluated, but you didn't do that. You did a very good job of good eye contact. You gave an example of vocal variety, what they would look at. Not only did you say Jeff could have used some more, but you gave a good example. You gave the usual very, very thorough, insightful evaluation, a good balance between compliments and constructive criticism. One suggestion I would say, perhaps use a little more stage movement, because an evaluation is a speech also, and that's part of a good speech. Will, you didn't greet the audience both in your introduction and your review, so you were consistent with that. You went through the manual. You referred to the pun that Sudeep used, "so deep." I thought that was very clever. Had positives and suggestions for him. And a good suggestion, visual aids. You gave a very lyrical evaluation. And when you gave the evaluation, you were mostly looking at Sudeep. Again, try to make eye contact with the rest of the audience. Art evaluated Mahesh. You greeted the audience both times. You went through all the preliminaries of project, etc. You started out with compliments about his speech. You went through the objectives. As always, a very insightful evaluation. I very much enjoy your evaluations. Again, stage movement as a suggestion. You planted yourself in front of the audience. Could have moved. Will, as the table topics evaluator, you picked one compliment and one suggestion for each speaker, which is good. Both of those were very, very insightful, and I don't have any suggestions for you. Thank you. And now, let me introduce our Toastmaster, Jean Symington Craig, to give out awards.
Pressure is building.
Well, Okay. We'll do best table topics first. That's the drum roll. Hey, that feels good, doesn't it? Ephraim!
tonight. I think more guests than members. What does that mean? So why don't the guests stand up and tell us your name and one thing you liked about the meeting.
My name is Isaac. I liked that the meeting was inclusive, that most of the audience were involved. Obviously, except
not
for me, but most people
are
involved in the speeches.
So thank you.
My name is Apollo. I like the meeting, and like he said, everyone contribute, communicate each other. So next time I will be one of them to communicate with you guys.
Good.
Thank you.
Gabe, I like how everything is on time.
When I came to my first Toastmasters meeting, I said the same thing. I really appreciate you starting and stopping on time. Cassie.
My name is Cassie. I think everybody is so good.
My name is Jack. I think we are together and we can learn from each other and we can share our perspectives. I think this is very good. And I also want to be a member of the Toastmasters.
Beautiful. Well, thank you guests for coming. If anyone is interested in membership, you can talk to Ephraim, not officially a member, I'm just looking ahead. Please stand up.
Okay. I like the diversity here. Africa, Asia, America, teen, everybody was here. Elves, young. So it was great. Yeah.
We cover the world. I'd just like to make a... Pretty good? It was pretty good. Comment on the meeting. I understand it was Will's first time doing the agenda, and he was battling illness, so we can forgive him. But there was some information that wasn't on the agenda. Some people who weren't here were on the agenda. Some people who were on the agenda wasn't here, which you have no control over. I would just encourage all speakers to get your title to Will before the meeting starts. That way, we can put it on the agenda. Just pay a little more attention to that.
How long before the meeting starts?
I guess as soon as you get the email, look through it, and if you notice you're a speaker, send it to Will. Or
yeah.
You can really just reply to the Toastmasters email and he'll get it.
Yeah, so that would be like 2 or 3 days.
Yeah,
not 15 minutes.
15 minutes is not good.
No.
Agenda's already printed by them.
Yeah.
One thing, we think we're going to have our fall speech competition, our club competition on September 20th, and the area competition on October 4th, which we'll have here at the Toastmasters meeting. These are both Tuesdays. Some of you may be interested. This is a humorous speech competition along with table topics evaluation competition. So I would encourage you, if you think you're funny, to enter the humorous speech competition. And if you're not funny, enter the evaluation competition.
Have your funny date on that?
So does those dates seem okay to everybody, the 4th and the 20th? Is there any national holidays we missed or some special thing?
We have hit Passover. We have hit some not so good days for people, so we just want to make sure we're not stepping on a important
day. Yeah. So we'll also send you an email, and if any objections to the dates, let us know. Otherwise, those will be the dates that we'll have. Yes, Jean.
I just mentioned one thing. So it's evaluation, and just like we do up here, 2 to 3 minutes. So you can be in the competition for that. And then the humor speech, just the criteria, it's 5 to 7 minutes. So it's 5 to 7 minutes, funny speech, and it'll be fun. And that's, so you have, you know, on your mark, get set, go. You can start working on it right now, start thinking about what you want to do, and then we'll have a really good contest. Yeah.
And plus you can get a credit for a speech in the manual for the humorous speech competition. So you can fit it into one of your competent communicator speeches, or if you're doing an advanced manual, humorous manual or something, you can fit it into that. So I want to thank you all for coming, thank our guests for coming. I want to thank our members for being flexible and switching around roles at the last minute. Thank you very much. See you next time.